dependence, excuse me. And so there's a tendency in the late 1970s and the early 80s to add women into the mix of research. So a lot of research goes on focusing on women migration, women, female migration, and women as migrants, not necessarily at looking at the dynamics, gender dynamics of males and females in migration. So in the 1980s, there's a move now from saying, let's look, let's predominantly fill in the gap left by man the migrant, it's woman the migrant too, by looking more at gender relations and particularly in the household decision making, who's, how do males and females decide who's going to migrate? And how do you take care of all the household needs to migration when one or more is absent, so on and so forth. In the 1990s, and this is sort of where my period of intervention comes in too, is it, a move from looking at gender more specifically at the household and family level into higher levels of analysis. So looking at how gender is operative in migrant networks, in job opportunities, and employment structures, political institutions, state policies, and so on. And obviously, there also is the introduction of the transnational perspective on migration. And initially, the transnational perspective actually included race, class, and nation, but not gender. And so my close colleague and I, Patricia Pissar, said, well, what about gender in all of this? And so gender becomes a very important focus of our work for the early 2000s. And then the next phase is I'm identifying basically with gender. Now the press from many of us feminist scholars is to make it understood as a central organizing principle of migration, and therefore gender should always be in every aspect of research on migration. And in the period of time, well, that was maybe the apogee of that period was might have been the International Migration Review of 2006, if that is the case, for a wide variety of disciplines looking at migration and the importance of gender to migration. Not to immigration, but to migration. And then, of course, in the 2000s and up to the present, we have both the engagement of migration scholarship with intersectionality, which does not come out of migration, as well as policies here in Europe, certainly not in the United States, of gender mainstreaming. So that's kind of a brief overview. And in my particular assessment, I don't know if you can read that, but I felt like there's a lot of progress is made in bringing gender into migration in this period of time. Obviously, it's a long period of time, but particularly in the early 21st century, I felt very hopeful about what had taken place and that that indeed we were coming to a point where maybe a lot of migration scholars would seriously believe that gender is a central organizing principle in migrations and therefore it should never be overlooked. And so I was also involved to some extent, and I imagine some of the others of you were also involved in the UNISCO programs here in Europe, as well as the Metropolis programs, and so there was a lot of overlap between the scholarship and the policy makers, right, and dialogues and so on. So it was a wonderful, I thought, very high opportunity time. And so now I decided for this particular presentation, I would ask this fundamental question. So, where are we now? Recent scholarship on migration and recent scholarship on immigrants' integration, to what degree do we find a gender perspective at all, and maybe a very involved gender as an organizing principle and intersectionality of the hill. So it's a big picture presentation, which is why I wanted this presentation to proceed or come at the end, but not necessarily with the other papers that are more specific about DACA and the United States incorporation issues. I do want to add in a caveat that, as I was beginning to prepare for this particular presentation, I knew that the literature is enormous. It's an enormous literature, and I brainstorm all the ideas that you have and then try to see how they relate to one another and create a conceptual map of what you already think you understand today, because you'll never be able to go back to that starting point once you get involved in reading the literature. So I did that, and then I did the other 3 points. I started looking at the Annual Review of Sociology, International Migration Review, Journal of Ethnic and Migration Studies, and a few other important publications on immigration, to sort of see what's out there, what arises. Is gender, do we see gender in the titles of papers, and are people treating it as a variable, or are they treating it as a central organizing principle, and so on and so forth. So that was my methodology, and I'll show you my brainstorm. That's what a brainstorm kind of looks like, okay? And these are some of the elements that I came up with as I was brainstorming. And I was like, well, this is way too complicated for me to possibly present, even in a relatively long presentation. It's not 15 minutes. It's like I have more time than that. But as a good methodological scholar, too, I was like, oh, time, how do I deal with that? It's a data collection analysis. Anyway, you get the idea. It's like, I gotta wrap my arms around something a little bit more doable. So that's how I ended up deciding to look at some of these big review articles and major migration journals and so on. And I also went to our library and looked at the books. I used to be able to just, look at the books in the library, and it was manageable when I first started as a graduate student, and now it's completely unmanageable. And they're piled on top, all the migration books and everything. But I at least went, and I did a little bit of, searching online for things. And then the last thing I did was I specifically punched in gender, integration, migration, and tried to see what would come out in terms of articles that are available. Here are my broad patterns and findings. First one, there's a lot of research going on in which sex, let alone gender, is completely absent, even today. More research that it may say gender, but it's actually treating the variable sex, just differentiating between males and females, but not treating gender as a central organizing principle. Gender is featured in a variety of articles, but it is either not a central organizing principle, or what you find is that it appears in a variety of what I call, or other people call, gender silos, or certain areas where you kind of have to talk about gender. And so you see several of them mentioned in that list. And there are a few articles in which gender is featured and either mainstreamed or brought in intersectional. So it's not that doesn't happen. It's just that the vast majority, I would say, of what I found, and this is really looking at the migration literature. I haven't gotten quite specifically to the immigration literature, but the migration literature, unfortunately, and again, my methodology was certainly not random or scientific, but I was still trying to see what I could find, and I found absence is still possible, but there can be quite a bit of very important research and review articles where there's no mention of gender whatsoever. So what I want to talk, what my assessment was, is that most migration research still treats gender as optional and certainly not central nor obligatory to engage in any kind of gender analysis. But gender still truly matters to migration. So I'm going to provide now a really, really brief overview of some of the findings that in this preparation that I did, where I found that gender is important to integration. And since most of you are involved in political integration, and you saw that evident yesterday, I'm not going to speak specifically to that. tend to earn less and therefore have higher instances of poverty and so on. That's nothing that is anything new, and it just continues on to this day. In terms of looking at social integration, and particularly interfacing with a larger society, I think there's kind of some more rich information out there, but it's certainly not extensive information from what I know and what I have found in the preparation for this paper. Some interesting work which suggests that, and not surprising again, because men and women are in different sectors of the economy, they have different contexts with a larger society. So if you're in jobs that are in more public domains, you're going to probably see more of the larger society. But if you are a domestic worker, you're sort of sequestered, and you have very intimate contact, but with a small number of people who represent the larger society, which can have a disproportionate impact on one's sense of being integrated or not with a larger society. There's also some research which suggests that males integrate through sport and leisure activities, in particular through sporting activities, soccer being a big one here in Europe, and to some extent to drinking activities, being out in the bars and public. On the other hand, the research suggests that particularly when females have children, they're interfacing more with institutions like schools, medical care facilities, and so on. And then there's an interesting intersection between gender and sexuality in terms of interfacing with a larger society. And so this plays out in kind of two somewhat contradictory ways. One is that there's some research that looks at how girls and women sometimes report, and again, I see this astroceptor reminding me to say that the majority of this research does reflect migration from the global south to the global north, so we have to keep that in mind. But that girls and women report being less monitored in terms of their activities outside of the home than they do in their countries of origin. On the other hand, there's also some research that suggests that both women and men, in terms of migrants, will lift up their female sexuality as more pure than that of the women in the context of country of destination. So the classic paper here, which goes back a few years, is Yenna Spiritz's paper on Asian women and commenting about, we don't sleep around like white girls do. There's a kind of a juxtaposition. Our women are good, pure, and theirs are not so good, let's put it that way. So there's an interesting dynamic when you look at the intersectionality of gender and sexuality. And in terms of emotional integration, and I know this is a very hot topic, and I know many of you are working in it, you may be more familiar than I am, even on the gender effects, or at least some of the gendered findings, that this research to suggest that men are feel more disempowered and sometimes even emasculated in the new context. And this having to do with the ability to control the children, be able to punish the children as they desire, and also to control women and their families and households. And this often has the effect of not of leading them to want to go back to the return to the home country, the country of origin, so that they can reaffirm their masculinity there, and that the opposite, again, with the caveat of the types of research that we're drawing the conclusions from, occurs with females feeling more empowered, particularly if they're able to get into the paid labor force for the first time, and often not wanting to return back to the country of origin. So this can create some very gendered dynamics. consistent policy. Now, as you'll hear, there are local and even state-based immigration policies, but there's no national immigration policy. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to engage with this through four different papers that I'm going to talk about. First one being by Helma Lutz, who may be someone that you're familiar with. Her research, very well-known feminist and intersectional migration scholar from Goethe University in Germany. And her paper was published in GEMS, and GEMS is one of those GEMS, like G-E-M-S, really good journals where you find a lot of papers that are written about gender and not just about sex as a variable either. Now, her paper, as you can see in the title, it covers a wide-ranging set of topics, but I'm going to focus on only on one area, which reflects her research on emigration from Poland and the Ukraine, and Polish immigration and Ukrainian emigration to Germany. And what she was looking at in this particular paper is the media account of this emigration. And what she talks about is that in the early years, when she's talking about the early 2000s, there was a, you know, this is a period of time where there's still a lot of structural adjustment going on in these post-Soviet bloc countries. And she's basically saying that the states, both the Ukrainian state and the Polish state, as well as the Catholic Church and other institutions, are quite laudatory, or they're enthusiastic about the emigration going on to Germany. And the reason being, according to Lutz, is that it was helping alleviate the massive unemployment problems going on in those countries of origin. But then she marks a tremendous shift that takes place in, starting in 2008, and she says they reverse their views and they become anti-immigration from those countries. And what she says is that what flips it is these media accounts of children, just some children, certainly not the majority of children, being of the immigrants being left in orphanages, and these orphanage children being hyped in the media. So what she said is that, what she writes is that what can be observed now is a strong tendency to criticize and scandalize the actions of parents, in particular of mothers, the pattern that we identify in, as the logic of naming, blaming, and shaming. Naming, blaming, and shaming, which I found very, very powerful in, as I was reading other papers, is naming, blaming, and shaming. So, she argues, Lutz argues, that, why do this? I mean, women were not stay-at-home mothers in either of these countries, right? They were already, for a long period of time, in the paid labor force. There was no attention to the fact that the states themselves had some responsibility for why people had to leave, and particularly mothers had to leave the country to be able to have enough income to maintain their families. So he concludes, at least in this section, that gendered expectations for behavior lead to gendered evaluations of the migrants and migration, and these impact official attitudes towards the migration and then lead to pressure to change immigration policy. And so gender has this multiple effect. And what I like about her paper also is how it links the microscale of decision making, in other words, people deciding in their families and their households that they need to emigrate, to higher levels of analysis in public opinion, institutions, and state policies. And she also, and this is kind of something that really struck me when I was doing my own reading, she also illustrates the disproportionate power of publicized events driving policies. What as an anthropologist, I would probably call a moral panic, which is a very common phenomenon that we see, a moral panic of, oh, this is happening, this is not good, about, you know, the fabric of our society, this is something, but it's a gendered moral panic. The next paper I want to discuss is one by Nina Sarriye of the European University Institute in Florence, also published by GEMS, and she's looking at recently published a print on female asylum seekers who are from not integrated into Europe, but her paper documents how the staff at the center treat the female asylum seekers. There were men asylum seekers there too, but she was focusing her research on female asylum seekers. They were divided. They could not be in the same location. She was looking at how they treat these female asylum seekers as if they were going to enter Europe. And they try to civilize them to European standards with regard to proper gender relations, that they should know how to behave in terms of gender in Europe, proper personal hygiene, as well as European multiculturalism. So they were teaching European values to these women, and they were held in this city and holding them accountable for the behavior there during the period of time that they were there to these particular standards. And what she concludes is that the staff members' rhetoric of integration really only serves to increase the authority and power of these staff over the asylum seekers. It's about disciplining them as they keep them physically segregated from and certainly not integrated into Spanish society. What I like about her paper is that she really examines the tie between gender policy and integration policy, but she doesn't really tell us the history of how they become entwined. And for that, we turn to two papers by Courtauld, Anna Courtauld and collaborators. And what they are looking at is the genesis of, as well as the implementation of these integration policies from different countries, and they use an intersectional framework. The first paper, which you see here, only examines the processes of bringing the gendered implementation of integration policy in the case of the Netherlands, and then the last paper I will briefly introduce you to also extends their analysis to Britain and Germany. The argument by Courtauld and Kyriada Thalopoulos is, quote, "Integration policy debates are usefully thought of as negotiations over how best to craft a shared national identity in a social context transformed by immigration. From this perspective, immigration policies aim to turn foreigners into subjects who engage in practices that make them fit into dominant societies. At the highest level of abstraction, integration policies seek to manage diversity by accepting those differences that do not overtly challenge the values and practices of the majority society, while attempting to alter those that are perceived as problematic." So basically what they argue is that in each society there's a kind of a target, or inside that target there's a bullseye. And that bullseye is values of shared national identity, that if people are immigrating in, they can have a variety of different values and different practices and different ideas, but they need to kind of fit with that shared national identity. And the story is one of those shared national identity values will be gender equity. And so this paper talks about how gender equity becomes part of that integration policy. Leading up to this period of time in the Netherlands, the Netherlands doesn't have, until the early 2000s, a national integration plan policy. But there's several critical events that impact the adoption of this integration policy, which will intersect gender policy with anti-Islamic policy in important ways. And so there's a couple of events that you'll see here. Is at the turn in 2000, you see Paul Schoeffer's full-page newspaper article condemning multiculturalism and stirring this whole revisionist thinking about multiculturalism. You have 9/11, and obviously the concern for or the commencement of anti-Islamic sentiment. And then you have a few days before the 2002 Dutch elections, the murder of even though his party goes on to win second place in the Dutch elections in 2002. So these are helping now to push the this conversation over the integration plan in the Netherlands towards an anti-Islamic stance. But But it will nonetheless, as the paper argues, there's a growing anti-immigrant and particular anti-Islamic sentiment in the Netherlands. However, the policy adopted took on a highly gendered turn, intersecting gender with religion, citizenship, status, nationality, and ethnicity by linking integration policy to an older national strategy of gender parity in the workforce. And so a lot of what this paper does is talk about how that gender parity arises from the 1970s when the Dutch government begins to say, obviously the feminist movement is very important here, gender equity in the workplace and in the home should be a national value. How do we get there? Well, we get there by increasing women in the paid labor force. What women are in the paid labor force? Well, let's stimulate women into the paid labor force, and then finding that the Dutch women are increasing their numbers in the paid labor force, but that immigrant women are lagging behind. And which immigrant women? Well, Islamic immigrant women. Not all. So they become sort of the problem. So that in this particular paper, when they do adopt in 2003, again a year after that election, they adopt an integration policy. It is a notably gendered integration policy, but one also intersecting with this anti-Islamic sentiment. So it was called the Plan to Address the Emancipation and Integration of Women and Girls from Ethnic Minorities, and its quote, explicit goal was to increase ethnic minority women and girls' participation in Dutch society. The national level integration plan focused on improving Dutch language learning, employment, and social dialogue while creating participation teams consisting of highly successful ethnic minority women who could stimulate other ethnic minority women to do the same. And so they also wanted to teach gender equity in the schools and have it in citizenship tests and so on and so forth. The paper goes on to explore the gendered implementation of the plan, and I don't have time to discuss it, but what I found particularly useful in this paper is the narration of how policymakers manipulated a broad social issue around solving gender inequity into naming, blaming, and shaming immigrants, and particularly Islamic immigrants. So a national integration policy was adopted and implemented, exploiting this progressive value in order to otherwise and stigmatize a particular sector of the population. Now, Cordaway publishes a more recent article with Yurtekul, I always mispronounce that when I say it to myself, and they extend the same kind of analysis to Germany and Britain, and what they find is that there's the same kind of gender equity being brought into conversation with gender integration plans. But they also talk about, and this goes back to the Lux's paper, about these publicized events and the disproportionate impact that these events have. And you can see in the title of their paper, Honor Killings and Forced Migration and Marriage Debates. And I don't have time to get into discussion of these events, but I highly suggest that you read this paper because it's really wonderful. The work is really terrific, and I think it shows the potential for really bringing gender in as both an organizing principle of migrations and policies, and also an intersection with other axes of identification. And what these events do is another instance, basically a kind of moral panic of the broader society, basically saying these people with their honor killings, they're undermining our basic values and what we care about, and so on. And it was reminiscent, although it's not mentioned in this particular paper, as I recall, of thinking myself when I heard about the papers, I come to a troubling conclusion that after years of struggle, policies to promote gender equality and ensure gender mainstream had been used to demarcate boundaries between so-called European values and those of immigrant countries of origin, particularly Islamic countries. They serve as intersectional tools to stigmatize and to use that refrain again, to name, blame, and shame certain people. This is not at all what I think feminist scholars and activists desired, and I include myself in that. So when I come to my third, where are we in terms of gender and immigration, I just return back to the early 2000s when I was quite optimistic and hopeful that I saw that gender was being brought in and that there was a lot of exciting directions going on. I felt very affirmed by gender mainstreaming policies in the European Union and of the dialogues with policymakers and scholars here in particular, not so much in the United States. Now I feel more skeptical. I really feel that the ground has shifted, and it's shifted in ways that are very concerning to me. One of the things that I note is that we continue to have gendered othering. Who are the ultimate others, and how important gender is to identifying who is outside of the acceptable realm of us. So on the left, you can see a gang member from the Mara Sanda Trucha from El Salvador, and kind of this masculinization of fear. Trump often would point to Mexican rapists and drug dealers and so on and so forth, but it was masculinized on the European side. Women, and particularly Islamic women, not providing evidence of gender equality in that being used. I feel like we are at a time really of, didn't mean to get there, concern and fear as well, although the well kind of got flipped, I'm sorry, that we're in a time, I think, where the whole world is moving. You know, when there's a tremendous amount of fear, there's a tendency for people to gravitate towards security, right? Security and stability and going back in time to a mythic period of when things were much better. But it also is a very masculinist protectionism that we're in now, where men, are the soldiers. You see these autocratic leaders, overwhelmingly autocratic leaders that are masculine, promising to bring stability to the world, and that females need to be protected in this, this particular time period. It's interesting, maybe I'm not the only one who perceives this masculinist protectionism that's going on, but it's interesting that it coincides with a period in human history of the highest level of achievement by women and girls in terms of education and employment, and access into many sectors of employment that were closed to us beforehand. So I think to conclude that gender still matters. Gender still matters to integration. It matters to context of reception. And I think as those of us who are studying gender, those of us who are really focusing on integration, we are in a period of time of an extremely hostile context of reception. The United States is one case, but certainly not the only case, of hostility to reception and of a turn to a much more masculinist approach to protectionism.